Hi dear friends. Dear friends, in the last part of the video, we discussed the second collective property which is entitled as the elevation of boiling point. Before that, we also discussed about the one of the important collective property which is known as the lowering of vapor pressure, and this lowering of vapor pressure also decides the another collective property that we discussed in the previous part, which is known as the elevation of boiling point. Dear friends, today, now in this part of the video, we would like to discuss the next collective property, which is simply known as the depression of freezing point. Dear friends, before discussing the depression of freezing point, we should know what is the freezing point. Then we will discuss about the depression of freezing point. Almost this depression of freezing point again depends upon the vapor pressure of pure solvent. So this freezing point is simply the temperature at which the vapor pressure of liquid becomes equal to that of solid into which it freezes. It means that whenever the temperature at which vapor pressure of liquid becomes equal to solids, then the temperature is known as the freezing point. So here it's very important, the conversion of liquid, whenever we are decreasing the temperature, it will be converted to solid, and the temperature at which the vapor pressure of liquid becomes equal to its solid, that temperature is known as the freezing point. Now, dear friends, we would like to discuss what is the effect of addition of solute on the vapor pressure of solvent and the solution, or solvent in the solution, which will decide the freezing point. So we would like to discuss the effect of addition of solute in the solvent on its freezing point. Dear friends, if you look here, this is the graph that indicates the change in the vapor pressure of pure solvent, and this is the line that indicates the change in the vapor pressure of solution. Now, after decreasing the temperature at point P0, what happens? The vapor pressure of solid becomes equal to the vapor pressure of solvent, means the liquid. That's why at point P0, this temperature is called as the freezing point of pure solvent, indicated by means of a T0. While at point P prime, at a pressure P prime, the vapor pressure of solution, means the liquid, becomes equal to the vapor pressure of liquid solvent, and the corresponding temperature is known as the freezing point of solution. If we will compare the freezing point of solution and that of solvent, as the vapor pressure of pure solvent is greater than the vapor pressure of solution or the solvent in solution, the freezing point of solution, here this T, the freezing point of solution is always lower than the freezing point of pure solvent, indicated by means of a T0. That's why we can conclude that on addition of non-volatile solute in the solvent, the freezing point always decreases, and that's why this is known as the depression freezing point. As we got the two freezing points, one is the freezing point for the pure solvent, indicated by T, and another one is the freezing point for the solution, indicated by T0. And the difference between these two means the freezing point of pure solvent minus freezing point of solution, this difference is called as the depression of freezing point, which is indicated by means of simply delta TF. Now, dear friends, if you look at the vapor pressure for the solid and vapor pressure for the solution, now we are having the two pressures and the two temperature. Pressure, vapor pressure P0 at temperature T0 and P prime at temperature T, while for the solution, pressure P at T0 and pressure P prime at T. So here this can be shown here simply, that is nothing but the for the pure solvent pressure P prime at temperature T and pressure P0 at temperature T0. And for the solution, that is for the solution, pressure P prime at T and pressure P at temperature T0. So we are going to apply the Clausius-Clapeyron equation to these two curves. So simply we are getting the two pressures and the two temperature ln of, already we have applied this equation, Clausius-Clapeyron equation for elevation of boiling point also. But here in this case we are going to apply this Clausius-Clapeyron equation for two curves, one for the solid solvent, another one is for the solution. So for the solid solvent we are getting the equation ln of P prime upon P0 is equal to minus Ls upon R into bracket, it's very important, into bracket 1 upon T minus 1 upon T0, where this Ls is the latent heat of sublimation. Similarly for the solution, again ln of P prime upon P is equal to minus Lu upon R in the bracket 1 upon T minus 1 upon T0. Dear friends, the relationship between latent heat of sublimation, latent heat of vaporization and the latent heat of fusion is given by this equation, that the latent heat of sublimation is always the sum of latent heat of fusion and the latent heat of vaporization. And if we will modify this equation by multiplying this cross multiplication, we are getting simply this equation, and if we will again modify this, simply we are getting this equation ln of P prime upon P0. Only difference is that this T0 minus T, and this again becomes T0 minus T divided by T0 into T. As this is applicable for the dilute solution, the difference between T0 minus T, which is delta Tf, is very small. That's why T0 minus T is nearly equal to 0, and it means T0 is nearly equal to T, and that's why T0 into T, this multiplication becomes T0 square. And after putting this delta Tf, T0 minus T is equal to delta Tf, and T into T0 is equal to T0 square, we are getting this equation for the pure solvent, and for the solution we are getting this equation. So this, in this way we are getting the two equation, one is this, another one is the this, and by subtracting the equations this minus this, we are getting ln of P upon P prime, because this P prime and P prime will get cancelled, in the bracket L minus, in the bracket Ls minus Lv, because this minus this, that is this minus this. So definitely Ls minus Lv, because we are subtracting the equation, that is 2.20 from 2.90, means that is this minus this, first minus second. So that's why definitely Ls minus Lv outside the bracket, there will be negative sign, and this delta Tf divided by RT0 square is the constant. So instead of this Ls minus Lv, we can put latent heat of fusion per mole of the substance, and we are getting simply this equation that ln of P upon P0 is equal to minus Lf into delta Tf divided by RT0 square. But by using the Rolle's law, we have the equation for the Rolle's law indicated by this P upon P0 is equal to always 1 minus X2. If we'll put this equation in this equation, then we are getting this equation ln of 1 minus X2 is equal to minus this term. And after simplification of this term, that is ln of 1 minus X2, simplification of this for the dilute solution is minus X2. And if we'll put this minus X2 in this equation, minus minus becomes plus, and we are getting equation for delta Tf is equal to RT0 square into Lf. This is latent heat of fusion per mole of the substance into X2. And from this we can conclude the delta Tf, means the depression of freezing point, is directly proportional to the mole fraction of solute X2, which is N2 upon N1 up plus N2. And for the dilute solution, we know N1 plus N2 becomes N1, means N2 upon this X2 becomes N2 upon N1, and this can be converted into weight divided by molecular weight, because number of moles is the ratio of, that is weight divided by molecular weight. And simply we are getting from simplification of this, we are getting the simple equation for delta Tf as this equation. This whole terms RT0 square divided by 1000 into LF. This LF is the latitude of fusion per gram of the substance, because it is this LF whenever divided by the molecular weight of the solvent, then we are getting this small LF. So all this term RT0 divided by 1000 into LF, these all are the constant, and instead of this we will take another constant. That constant is indicated by means of n Kf, and that's why we are getting simply the equation for delta Tf into Kf into m. This Kf is called as a cryoscopic constant, and this is called as the molal depression constant for one molal solution. One molal solution means freezing point of 1 kg of solvent when 1 mole of solute is dissolved in it. So this is the depression of freezing point for one molal solution, Kf. And there are two methods which are used for the determination of molecular weight of solute by using depression freezing point. The first one is the Rast method, and the second one is called as the Bakeman method. Now, how we can determine the molecular weight of the solute? Again, this we have the formula here. M2 is the molecular weight of solute, Kf is the cryoscopic constant of the solvent, W2 is the weight of solute in gram, W1 is the weight of solvent, delta Tf is the depression of freezing point, and here Kf can be calculated by putting the values of all these constant. R is the Rydberg constant, Latin rate of fusion per gram is 333, T0 273, R 8.314. By putting all this, the cryoscopic constant means this Kf is simply 1.86 Kelvin per kg per mole. So this is the simple thing. Here we can discuss one example based upon the same, how we can determine the molecular weight of solute by using depression of freezing point. For that purpose, here one numerical is given. The solution containing 0.194 gram urea in 100 gram of water was found to freeze at minus 0.06 degree Celsius, and calculate the molecular weight of urea, and the freezing point of water is provided, which is 0 degree Celsius, and the Kf is also provided for the water, 1.86. Delta Tf is the difference between the freezing point of solvent minus freezing point of solution. So freezing point of water is 0 degree Celsius, means it is in Kelvin 273 minus 272, because the freezing point is decreased by minus 0.06. So 273 minus 0.06, and this become 272.94, and that's why the delta Tf is the 0.06. and here the solution of urea is prepared. So this is the value of W2 in W1 gram, means 100 gram. So W1 is equal to 100 and W2 is equal to 0.194. Kf is also given, 1.86, and by putting all this value, the molecular weight of solute is, that means urea, is here simply 60.14 gram per mole. So this is a way how we can calculate the molecular weight by using the depression freezing point. And this is one of the method which is used to determine the molecular weight of solute, unknown solute, by using the depression of freezing point. This method is called as the Rast method. In this method, this method is used for the determination of molecular weight of unknown solute. And here weight of solute, particularly this is used for the solutes which are dissolved in the camphor. And the depression of freezing point is also so large, that's why the ordinary thermometer can be also used in this method. In this case, is the simple process is that actually in this case, this is the capillary tube which is used in the Rast method. In this case, the thermometer is deep in one capillary tube, and this capillary tube is placed in one a beaker, in which the stirrer is there, and this is, in this case, the known amount of camphor is taken into the tube, which is heated to melt, and up to certain time its temperature is decreased, and it is allowed to decrease the temperature, and the readings are taken. The decrease in temperature at various time is taken, and after melting this, the given solute is mixed in this camphor, and the same procedure is repeated. So from its melting point, it is allowed to decrease its temperature, and at particular time interval, the readings are taken of the decrease in temperature. The similar things can be applicable, similar process can be repeated with the different weight of solute, and in this way we are getting some constant temperature, and that temperature is known as the freezing point of solvent as well as freezing point of solution, and the difference between these two is known as the depression and freezing point. So this is second method is known as the Beckmann method. Actually this is the apparatus, which is used in this method, and the thermometer which is used particularly in this method is called as Beckmann thermometer. It is not the ordinary thermometer, that's why this method is called as the Beckmann method. In this case, a known weight of solvent is placed in a freezing tube which is fitted with the stirrer and the Beckmann thermometer, and the definitely here in this case the freezing tube is placed in another tube, not directly in the paraffin oil. The freezing tube is placed in another tube, leaving the air space prevent the freezing of the solvent on the walls of the freezing tube, and the whole assembly is placed in a covered vessel containing the freezing mixture, and by means of stirrer in the outer vessel, here this is the stirrer, you can observe, by means of stirrer in the outer vessel the freezing mixture is stirred, and the temperature of the solvent in the freezing tube is allowed to fall about 0.5 degree below the freezing point of the solvent, and that's why the solvent it becomes supercooled, because it is allowed to fall below its freezing point, so definitely the solvent will become solid, and this process is called supercooled. The supercooled liquid is then vigorously stirred, causing crystallization, or it leads to crystal, because small disturbance to the supercooled liquid will result into the formation of crystal, and the process is called as crystallization. That will begin, and the temperature rises the freezing point, and it remains constant, and this is called as the freezing point of the solvent, and this freezing tube is then removed, and the solid solvent is again allowed to melt, and a known amount of experimental solute or the given solute is added to this tube, and it is again heated, and definitely the process is repeated in the similar way, and the freezing point of the solution can be determined exactly with the help of this method for the pure solvent as well as mixture. And this is the particular thermometer which is called as the Beckmann thermometer which is used, and that's why this method is called as the Beckmann method. Actually this thermometer consists of the large bulb of mercury connected, here you can observe large bulb of the mercury connected by fine capillary, this is the fine capillary reservoir at the top, and here it has the reservoir at the top, because other thermometers are having the reservoir at the bottom, but this is having the reservoir at the top. This is the main difference. There are 5 to 6 divisions on the scale, and each division is referred to as the degree Beckmann, and each degree is divided into hundreds of division. You can observe here this has the hundreds of division, and most of the mercury from the reservoir is got into the bulb, so that the freezing point of the solvent is obtained near the top of the thermometer, and see easy to observe the freezing point of the solution is always lower than that of the pure solvent, and that's why when the freezing point of the solution is determined the mercury level falls. The difference can be read very accurately to the hundredth of degree. That's why it's very easy to record the falling temperature by using this thermometer. So dear friends, in this way we have discussed about the next or the third qualitative property which is entitled as the depression of freezing point. We also discussed about how we can determine the molecular weight by using the depression of freezing point, and what are the methods which are used to determine the determination of depression of freezing point, which leads to or which is helpful to determine the molecular weight of given solute. So this is one of the important colligative property in which we discussed about the two methods, the Rast method and the Beckmann method, which are used to determine the depression of freezing point or to determine the molecular weight of given solid by using depression of freezing point. So dear friends, in this way we will resume in the next part of the video to discuss about the next colligative property, which is known as the osmotic pressure. Thank you very much.